Good morning, students. So today I am again going to repeat the same topic, that is amenity. It's a very important topic, so I want to take it again. So students, what is amenity? Sometimes what happens, you are coming in contact with so many types of pathogens, antigens in your daily life. But what you see that all of these pathogens, these antigens, they do not cause any harm to you. Sometimes your body protect itself from the effect of these pathogens, these disease-causing organisms. So what is there present in your body? The student, it is amenity. So what is amenity? If you have to define it, then it is the overall ability of the host organism, or you can say the body of the host organism, to fight against the disease-causing pathogens or antigens, or those undesirable substances which are trying to enter into the body of the host organism. So it is the overall capacity, overall ability of the host organism to deal with these kind of infections. So students, we have two types of amenity. Innate amenity, as the name itself indicates, that such type of amenity is present in our body from the time of our birth. That means it is a gifted amenity. We obtain this amenity from the time of our birth. And second is acquired amenity. What is acquired amenity? Acquired amenity is that amenity which develops in your body when your body comes in contact with any pathogen, any antigen. Or any pathogen or antigen, it tries to enter into your body. Then a kind of amenity or your immune system, it becomes active. And an amenity is shown by your body. That is known as the acquired amenity. So it only establishes in your body when your body comes in contact with the pathogen or the antigen. Okay, students. So first of all, we are talking about the innate amenity. So innate amenity is a non-specific type of amenity. It is present in our body from the time of your birth. So there are different type of barriers that are there in your body. And these barriers, they do not allow the entry of the pathogens. Or if the pathogen, it enters in your body, then these special type of barriers, they play a significant role in killing that particular pathogen. So here I am going to discuss about the four types of the innate amenity or barriers that comes under innate amenity. So number one is physical barriers. So student, what are physical barriers? You know that your skin is the particular covering that comes in contact with the external environment. So your skin acts as the main barrier. It do not allow the entry of the microorganisms. You know that your skin is made up of epithelial tissue. A compound epithelia is there, which forms the lining of your skin, covering of your skin. And that's why the pathogens or the microbes, they cannot enter into your skin. Besides this, there is also the mucus coating of the epithelium. It forms lining over your important organs, such as your respiratory tracts, your gastrointestinal tracts, your urogenital tracts. So all of these linings that is made up of mucus coating of epithelia, they protect all of these important organs. So the pathogen, they are not able to invade these organs. And if it accidentally enters, then it cannot survive. Second is physiological barriers. As you know, the term physiology is concerned with biochemical things. Okay, students. So there are some of the important chemicals present in your body. For example, your stomach have a acid and saliva is present there in your mouth. And tears are there in the lacrimal gland that are present in your eyes. So all of these, they prevent the entry of the pathogens. And they do not allow the pathogen to survive. Then cellular barriers. So there are certain cells which act as barriers. For example, all of these cells, they are collectively known as the polymorphonuclear leukocytes. So there are different type of leukocytes comes under this, such as neutrophils, monophils, monocytes, mast cells, natural killer cells, and also in your tissues, macrophages cells are present, and they do the task of phagocytosis. So whenever a pathogen enters into your body, then these type of cells, they get active. They try to kill the pathogen and later they become successful. So last one is the cytokinin barriers. As the name itself indicates, sometimes your body is suffering from some viral infection. Then what happens? Some of the cells, they get damaged by the entry of the virus. As the virus, it causes lysis of the cells. But these dying cells, they protect the other cells by releasing certain chemicals. And these chemicals are known as the interferons. So the dying cells, they are doing their job. They are protecting the other cells. They do not allow the viral particles to enter these cells by producing specific type of chemicals, which are known as interferons. Okay, students, acquired immunity. You know that this kind of immunity only active, it gets active in your body when you are coming in contact with certain pathogen or a pathogen try to enter into your body. Or you can say it enters into your body. Then what happens? Your body show immune responses. So first time when your body comes in contact with the pathogen, then the cells which are present in your body related with defense, they get active. And they produce first time immune response, which is of low intensity. It is known as primary response. And later on, when the same pathogen it enters into your body, then a secondary response is produced by your body, which is of high intensity. Now, what is the thing here is, here special type of cells are present, which are known as B lymphocytes and T lymphocytes. These B lymphocytes are those lymphocytes which are produced in the bone marrow, and they remain in the bone marrow for rest of their lifespan. And these T lymphocytes, they are actually, they are synthesized in the bone marrow, but later they move towards the thymus gland and they stay there for their lifetime. So what happened? These T lymphocytes, they are actually the informers. Whenever a pathogen or antigen, it enters into your body, then this information is carried by the T lymphocytes. And these T lymphocytes, they convey the message to the B lymphocytes. And what happened? These B lymphocytes, they produce army of proteins. And that army of protein is known as antibodies, which are proteinaceous in nature. So these antibodies, which are present in your blood, and they kill the pathogen, they have a special type of molecular structure. So here the antibody molecule, it is itself made up of two polypeptide chains. Two of the chains, they are larger one, known as the larger units. And the other two chains, polypeptide chains, are the smaller units. So antibody molecule, it is represented by the symbol H2L2. Alright? So here, as the immune response is shown towards the pathogen with the production of these large number of antibodies, so such type of immune response is known as humoral immune response. Okay, students? So the second type of acquired immunity, it is actually the cell-mediated immunity. Students, here I have written the definition of the humoral immune response. So here four type of antibodies are present in your body, IgA, IgM, IgE, and IgG. So out of these IgA, it is present in the colostrum milk, that is the milk produced by the mammary gland of the mother when first time delivery takes place for the infant, all right? And second one is IgE. These are the antibodies that are concerned with allergic reactions. Sometimes your body shows certain type of allergy, and at that time, this IgE type of antibodies are present, okay? Now I am starting with cell-mediated immunity. So here it is known as cell-mediated immunity because the chief type of cells that are concerned here is the T lymphocytes. So these T lymphocytes are actually those lymphocytes whose maturation takes place in the thymus gland, and they stay in the thymus gland for their action. Okay, students. So these type of cells, they are generally seen in case of organ transplantation. Sometimes the body of the patient, it is facing certain organ failures. Your kidney get fail, or your heart, or your lungs. So transplantation is required in that. So what doctor said, doctor are usually finding a donor for this. So why they are searching for the donor? Because these donors should be a person whose graft, or the, you can say skin graft, or the bloodstream, it actually matches with the patient. Why there is a need of this? Because here is an immune response known as cell-mediated immunity. And here the T lymphocytes are the actual cells. And these cells have the ability to identify the self cells and the non-self cells. So if we have to transplant certain foreign organ into the body, then it can be easily recognized by these T lymphocytes. and they try to kill that forward point. So in that case, in order to suppress the activity of these T lymphocytes, generally the doctors, they give immunosuppressants to the patient throughout their lifetime so that the organ transplantation can be successful. So these T lymphocytes are actually concerned with the cell-mediated immunity. Okay, this is the diagram of the cell-mediated immunity. The different type of T lymphocytes are here. Helper T cells, then killer T cells, then memory T cells, all right? So active immunity, students, active immunity is a term that is used for a kind of immunity. Sometimes what happens? A pathogen in the form of a weakened state, whether it is a live form or it is in a dead form, it is injected into the body of the patient. And by the entry of this, the body of the patient starts producing immune responses. In the same way as it is there in acquired immunity, humoral immunity. So first time it produced primary response, then a secondary response is there. So what happened, this primary response, when it is built up in the body, then a kind of memory cells is developed in the body because of the entry of this weakened strain. So next time when the natural infection, it is occurring in the body of the patient. So as the memory cell is already developed in the body, so these memory cells, they inform the body as soon as possible, and the body show the secondary response, and this secondary response is of high intensity. So millions of antibody molecules are there in the blood, and these antibody molecules, they kill the pathogen very soon. So in this way, the active immunity is a kind of immunity which is built in your body when your body is exposed to a pathogen. But sometimes it may be the case that you are suffering from certain disease. For example, you are suffering from chickenpox. And after chickenpox, the memory cells, they are developed in your body. So next time when the same pathogen of chickenpox, it enters in your body, then it is killed in few days because memory cells are there. So secondary response is of high intensity. So this type of immunity is known as active immunity. Okay, student, passive immunity is a different kind of immunity. Sometimes an immediate immune response is required. For example, some snake, it bites a person. In that case, it may be the chances that the person can be die within a few hours. So here we are not waiting for the active immunity to develop in the body. So here we have to inject ready-made antibodies into the blood of the patient so that rapid action should be taken. In that case, passive immunity, we have ready-made cells which are ready by us in the form of these antibodies, and they are injected in the patient's blood with the help of injections. So this type of immunity is known as passive immunity. You know very well that from the mother's blood during the process of delivery, the antibodies, it is secreted by the colostrum milk, which is the milk produced by the mammary gland of mother after the delivery for the newborn child, or you can say infant. So this type of colostrum milk, it contains so many antibodies that comes from the mother body into the child, because you know that the child is a newly born child. So his immune response is not very much active. In that case, the preformed antibodies, ready-made antibodies that comes from mother's body into the child in order to protect the child from any kind of diseases. So here I have written some important points. No lymphocytes are stimulated here in case of passive immunity to clone themselves, and no memory cells are there. And this type of passive immunity is effective also, but it is temporary. So it remains in the body for a short period of time as these antibodies are toxins. All right. So as long as the toxins, they are last in the body, at that time, the antibodies, they are active. After that, they are effective. Gets over. Okay, student, here some points are written about the active immunity. That active immunity, it is against a specific disease. As you know, it is a pathogenic specific type of immunity. So the antibodies, when it get developed, then it is according to the specific pathogen. So naturally acquired sometimes by the patient to certain disease. If there is some disease in the patient, then memory cells, it develops. And in this way, the immunity, it is built up. Artificially, sometimes it is injected into the body of the patient with the help of vaccination. So what we do in vaccination, includes certain inactive toxins or killed microbes or certain parts of microbes. And because of this, what happened? Primary response or memory cells, they are created in the body of the patient, and whenever that pathogen enter, these memory cells, they activate the immune response, and then secondary immune response is produced with kindness. Okay, students? So this type of active immunity is permanent, whereas passive immunity is, it is temporary. So antigens are only encountered in case of active immunity. So active immunity, it takes several weeks to develop. All right? Whereas passive immunity, it shows the immediate action. Okay, student, this is the picture of the passive immunity. Here a mother gave feed to her child, and immediate after the delivery, so the type of the milk is colostrum, yellowish color milk, and it is rich in antibodies. Okay, students, so these are the differences between the active immunity and the passive immunity. I'm going to read it for you. That active immunity produced actively by host immune system, whereas passive immunity, it is received passively. No active participation of the host immune system is there. Okay. And second point is active immunity induced by infection or by immunogens. Here, passive immunity, it is conferred by administration of ready-made antibodies. That means ready-made antibodies are ready in the laboratory and it is later injected into the patient. So active immunity have long-lasting and effective protection, whereas passive immunity have short-term and less effective. Fourth point is immunity effective only after lag period. That is time required for the generation of the antibodies is there in case of active immunity, and here immediate immunity is there in the body because ready-made antibodies are there and it are these are only injected into the patient's blood. Immunological memory is present here because memory cells develop, so here no memory is present. Booster effect on subsequent dose. So here subsequent dose it shows less effect. Okay, negative phase may occur. So here no negative phase occur. Negative phase means that the time period which is there in the body for the development of the antibodies. At that time, it needs certain time to develop. So that period is known as the negative phase. Okay, not applicable in immunodeficient situation, and these are applicable in immunodeficient situation. Okay, better. So next is vaccination. I have already explained what is vaccination. Vaccination is a kind of process in which what we do. So here we have produced certain substances, and these substances, they are against certain pathogens, and these substances, they are filled in the injections. They are injected into the body of the patient, and they are related with certain kind of pathogens. So how these vaccines, they are prepared? These vaccines, they are prepared with by injecting some dead pathogens or live pathogens. And these live pathogens or dead pathogens, when it is injected inside the host organism, okay, different type of host organism can be used for the purpose of preparation of vaccine. So here, different kind of bacteria are used, fungi are used, and in the body cells of these organisms, weak stain of the dead pathogens or some weak stain of the live organism, it is injected in the body, and in this way primary responses are built in the body of the respective host organism, and later that vaccine, it gets ready and it is collected from there and it is injected into the body of the humans. So in this way, a protection is provided against a deadly disease. Okay, the vaccine was first discovered by the scientist Edward Jenner, and he developed the vaccine for smallpox and cowpox disease. They, both of these are the viral diseases. Now vaccines are available for different kind of diseases like measles, mumps, poliomyelitis, TB, that is tuberculosis, smallpox, rubella virus, yellow fever, rabies disease, the disease that is caused by dog bite, typhoid is there, influenza, hepatitis B. All of these diseases, they have their vaccines ready. So vaccination is actually the process of distributing and administering vaccines, all right, in the body of the patient. Okay, student, immunization is a term that is synonymous with vaccination. So immunization is defined as a procedure by which the body is prepared to fight against a specific disease. All right. So it is used to induce the immune resistance of the body to a specific disease. So it may be passive immunization or active immunization. So we have explained very well about these. Okay, students, here I have written the procedure of the active immunization, that antigenic proteins of pathogen or inactivated weakened pathogen are introduced in the body. And later antibodies are produced, and these antibodies are in the form of memory cells. So whenever a pathogen enters, so next time the body shows secondary response. So two types of cells are involved. You know the name very well, B cell and T cell. And T lymphocytes, they form the B cells, and B cells, they produce army of proteins known as antibodies. You know the process. And what special in case of passive immunization? So here the person is, if infected with a deadly microbe, some scorpion has bite or some snake has bite, or the person is having a disease, tetanus or lockjaw, in that case, immediate immune response is required. So here we are not going to wait for the antibodies to develop in the body. So here we give ready-made antibodies into the patient body. That's why rapid action can be successful. So this type of immunization is known as passive immunization. Okay, student, that's all about the types of immunity. So here we have learned about the definition of the immunity. Then two types of immunity, innate and acquired immunity. Then acquired immunity is again of two types, humoral immune responses and cell-mediated immune responses. Then we have also learned about active and passive immunity. And then we have also learned about the vaccination, immunization. Then what is passive immunization? What is active immunization? So I'm quite hopeful that the concepts are clear to you. So please revise the concept once more and read the chapter carefully. Okay, student, that's all in today's lecture. Have a